creep rate, which is denoted by epsilon dot, that is derived from the slope of the creep curve d epsilon by dt. So creep rate, this is one of the important design parameter that is determined from the creep curve. So creep rate is d epsilon by dt, which I have not mentioned properly in the previous module. So creep rate is the slope of the curve. So this creep rate, it decreases in the first stage of creep, which is also known as primary creep. The creep rate decreases because during the plastic deformation, the number of dislocations will increase, the density of the dislocation increases and strain hardening takes place. In the second stage, that is the secondary stage creep, the creep rate is constant. It is constant at a minimum rate because the dislocation density cannot keep on increasing continuously because the recovery processes, that is dislocation, annihilation takes place. Thereby there is a balance between the strain hardening and recovery. So this is the secondary stage creep, where the increase in dislocation density, it is balanced by the annihilation of dislocations. Thereby the number of dislocation comes down, recovery process which takes place. So a balance between strain hardening and recovery is seen in the secondary stage creep, and the creep rate is constant at a minimum rate. And in the tertiary stage, that is the third stage creep, the creep rate increases and finally until the material undergoes rupture. In the case of stress rupture test, we have discussed the stress rupture test, stress versus time to rupture, where there is a change in the slope. In the case of stress rupture test, there is a change in slope at very high temperatures and high stresses due to metallurgical instabilities that take place. So this change in the slope or a sharp break in the curve, it is due to metallurgical instabilities. Instabilities that take place. These metallurgical instabilities are due to overaging. Second, due to the precipitation of brittle intermetallic phases. Due to the precipitation of brittle intermetallic phases, as well as carbides. So these are the reasons, some of the reason for the metallurgical instabilities which takes place, and that can be seen from the stress rupture curve, where there is a sharp change in the slope or sharp break in the curve. So now we will discuss these various metallurgical instabilities that causes a change in the metallurgical structure. So among the various, some of these are, the first is overaging. So we have discussed in the strengthening mechanism about the precipitation hardening, dispersion hardening, etc. So alloys, they can be strengthened by the precipitates. Some of the precipitation hardenable alloys, example that we have discussed is aluminium copper alloys, where the fine precipitates which form, they increase the strength of the material, because these fine precipitates, they act as obstacles to the dislocation motion. If the dislocation, they have to either cut the precipitates or they have to bend around the precipitates, and they have to bypass these obstacles in order to bypass these obstacles, either they have to cut the precipitates. If they are very fine, then cutting mechanism operates. If they are somewhat coarse, then bending operation, looping occurs. The dislocation, they have to bend around the precipitates. They have to bow around the precipitates and then they have to bypass. So, these are the strengthening mechanisms in the case of precipitation hardening. These fine precipitates which are coherent with the matrix, they contribute to high strength, because the dislocations, they have to either cut the precipitates or they have to bend around the precipitates in order to overcome these precipitate particles. Then in the case of dispersion strengthening, we have dispersoids. So, again these dispersoids, they act as an obstacles to impede the dislocation motion. And moreover, these precipitates at higher temperatures, they undergo coarsening because of the diffusion which takes place at higher temperatures. When these precipitates, they undergo coarsening, the number of the precipitates decreases and the precipitate size increases. So, when the distance between the precipitates are very large, then dislocations can easily bypass these precipitates. So, overaging at very high temperatures decreases the strength of the material, because dislocations can easily bypass them. So, the alloys which are strengthened by means of the precipitates, they undergo coarsening at higher temperatures. The precipitates undergo coarsening at higher temperatures and finally leads to lower strength of the material. So, this is about overaging which takes place at high temperatures. Nickel based alloys, aluminium alloys. So, among the case when considered with respect to nickel based alloy and aluminium alloys, nickel based alloys, they show better resistance. They show much increase in strength. That means the strength do not comes down even at higher temperatures. They can retain their strength even at higher temperatures, because the precipitate particles, the precipitates of the, in the case of nickel based super alloys, that is the precipitates are Ni3, AlTi. These precipitate, they do not coarsen very rapidly at higher temperatures, unlike in the case of aluminium alloys or other titanium alloys. Some of the stainless steel, pH stainless steels, precipitation hardenable stainless steels, all these are strengthened by the mechanism of precipitation strengthening mechanism. Aluminium alloys, some of the titanium alloys and that of the stainless steels, precipitation hardenable stainless steels, all these materials, they show a much increase in strength, mainly because of the formation of these precipitates. But these precipitates at higher temperatures, they undergo coarsening very rapidly. So, the material strength comes down at higher temperatures. An exception to this is the nickel based super alloys, where the intermetallic phase, that is the precipitates, they do not coarsen very rapidly when compared to that of these other alloys, because of the stoichiometry of this phase of this precipitate. It undergoes coarsening very slowly. So, these alloys, they can retain their strength even at higher temperatures. So, these super alloys, they are used in applications great at temperatures greater than about 540 degrees centigrade. So, this is one of the reason, that is overaging is one of the reason, that is one of the metallurgical instability, where at higher temperatures the metallurgical structure changes at higher temperatures and leads to low stress rupture life. That is overaging. Next, second is precipitation of intermetallic phases. Intermetallic phases. Some of the intermetallic phases, which are known as TCP phases, topologically closed pack phases. These phases, they lower the strength and ductility of the material. We have seen the strengthening phases in the case of aluminium alloys, in the case of precipitation hardening, where we have discussed, because of these fine precipitates, which increase the strength of that material. Some of the phases, they also precipitate, but because of the precipitation of these phases, the strength, toughness and ductility of the material decreases. So these phases, they causes embrittlement, which lowers the strength and ductility of the material because of the shape, size and distribution of the phases, they causes a lower in strength and ductility. The morphology, it is different. The morphology of this TCP phases, that is the shape and size and distribution, depending upon these, the shape, size and distribution, it increases the strength or it lowers the strength. TCP phases, which are known as topologically closed packed phases, topologically closed packed phases, example of these phases are sigma phase, sigma, mu, lavis. These are some of the phases. The shape of this phases, it is like plate like or needle like. It is plate like or needle like. This is the shape of this phases. Because of the precipitation of these phases, it lowers the strength and ductility of the material. Example is for the case of a nickel base super alloy. Nickel base super alloy, when a stress rupture test is conducted, stress versus log stress versus log rupture time, log rupture time, it is conducted, a sharp break in the curve, it is seen, a sharp change in the slope is seen at a temperature of about, this is for the case of a nickel base alloy U700, this is a nickel base super alloy. A sharp break in the curve or change in the slope occurs due to the precipitation of a brittle phase, that is the sigma phase. Due to the precipitation of this sigma phase, it lowers the rupture life of this, stress rupture life of this material. So at a temperature of about 815 degrees centigrade and a rupture life of about 1000 hours, a sharp break in the curve, it is seen when stress rupture test is conducted for this alloy at temperature of about 815 degrees centigrade at a time, log rupture time of about 1000 hours, a sharp change in the slope, a break in the curve is seen. That is mainly due to the precipitation of a sigma phase in the case of U700. This is a nickel base super alloy. In other super alloys also, the precipitation of this sigma phase do not cause the same effect, because these phases, they either increase the strength or lower the strength depending upon the shape of the phase, the distribution and the amount of phase. They either cause an increase in strength or lower in strength. If these phases, these precipitates, these brittle intermetallic phases, these intermetallic phases, if they have a shape like plate like or needle like, then they causes a decrease in strength and ductility of the material. They lower the stress rupture life. In the case of nickel base super alloy, that is U700, at a temperature of 815 degrees and log rupture time of 1000 hours, the precipitation of sigma phase, which is in the form of plate like and needle like, it causes a lower in rupture life, which can be seen from this curve, that is a sharp break in the curve. Then third is carbide reactions. Carbides reactions. The carbides which form at higher temperatures, if these carbides, they may be present within the grain or they may be present along the grain boundary. If the carbides, if they are present along the grain boundary, then they increase the creep resistance of the material, because these carbides which are present at the grain boundary, they cause a spinning at the grain boundary. That means they do not allow the grain boundaries to slide against each other and causes failure, okay, and causes intergranular fracture. So they pin the grain boundaries and they inhibit this grain boundary sliding. So carbides, they may form within the grain or they may form at the grain boundary. If they are at the grain boundary, they are beneficial because they do not allow the grains to slide over one another and leads to voids and finally leads to fracture. So they pin the grain boundaries and thereby they increase the creep resistance. And moreover, these carbides, they are beneficial if and only when they form along the grain boundary and in discrete. That means if this is a grain and the carbides, they form a continuous network along the grain boundary, then they lower the strength of the material as well as they lower the stress rupture life of the material, because carbides, when they form a continuous network along the grain boundary, they cause embrittlement and finally lowers the strength and creep resistance of the material. They should be discrete at the grain boundary. If instead of forming a continuous network, these carbides, if they form at the grain boundary in discrete, then they are beneficial to creep resistance. That means they increase the creep resistance because they pin the grain boundaries without sliding against one another. So the carbides which form, they are beneficial if they form along the grain boundaries and in discrete. That means they should not form a continuous network along the grain boundary. They are not beneficial if they form a continuous network along the grain boundary. So these are some of the metallurgical instabilities. That means the change in the metallurgical structure that occurs at some high temperatures and high stresses, which can be seen as a sharp change in the slope, a sharp break in the curve, in the log stress versus log rupture life curve. Some of the metallurgical instabilities are like overaging, where the precipitates which are beneficial at lower temperatures, at higher temperatures, diffusion takes place more rapidly and finally leads to coarsening of the precipitates, lowers the strength. Then the second is the carbide reactions which takes place. Carbide reactions, they are beneficial if and only if they form as discrete at the grain boundaries. If they form a continuous network along the grain boundaries, again they lower the strength of the material as well as they lower the stress rupture life of the material. And precipitation of intermetallic phases, some of the phases like TCP phases, which are known as topologically closed packed phases, like sigma phase, mu phase, lavice phase. So whether these phases, they increase the strength or lower the strength, it depends upon the size, shape and distribution of these phases. If they have a needle like or a plate like shape, then they lower the stress rupture life as well as they lower the strength and ductility, which can be seen in the case of when a nickel base super alloy U700 at temperature of about 815 degrees centigrade, rupture life about 1000 hours, a sharp break in the curve is seen, that is due to the precipitation of sigma phase. Now we shall discuss the various creep deformation mechanisms. The creep deformation mechanisms. Creep deformation mechanisms So the various creep deformation mechanisms, they are either controlled by simply the movement of dislocations, or they can be either only controlled by diffusion. So which mechanism, even though the various mechanisms, the creep deformation mechanisms, they operate at the same time But which mechanism is dominant, that can be determined, because the creep rate, which is maximum for the case of a particular deformation mechanism, that can be determined. And even though a number of deformation mechanisms, they operate at the same time, the dominant deformation mechanism can be determined by finding out the maximum creep rate that can be obtained from any one of the deformation mechanisms. So, the various creep deformation mechanisms are, we have dislocation creep, dislocation creep, which is governed by the motion of dislocation, that is dislocation creep. It is governed by the motion of dislocation. Then we have diffusion creep, where it is governed by the diffusion controlled mechanisms, that is diffusion creep. In diffusion creep, we have two type of mechanisms. So, this dislocation creep, it is governed by the motion of dislocations. It is governed by the motion of dislocations. And diffusion creep, it is governed by the diffusion controlled mechanisms. Diffusion controlled mechanism. So, which deformation mechanism is dominant? It depends upon a combination of stress and temperature. For a particular combination of stress and temperature, which deformation mechanism is dominant? That is, dominant means which deformation mechanism leads to a higher creep rate that can be determined, and we can say that this is the dominant deformation mechanism, even though other deformation mechanisms also operate at the same time. So, we have dislocation creep, which is simply governed by the motion of dislocation, and diffusion creep, which is mostly controlled by the diffusion mechanisms. So, this is governed by diffusion controlled mechanisms, and in this we have two types of diffusion creep. One is known as NH creep, that is Navarro-Herring creep and Coble creep. So, these two come under the diffusion creep, which are governed by diffusion controlled mechanisms. Then third, we have grain boundary sliding. So, the various creep deformation mechanisms that can be determined for a particular combination of stress and temperature. Okay. So, dislocation creep, which is governed by the motion of dislocations. So, a dislocation from a if this is a dislocation source and this is the slip plane, the dislocations from the dislocation source, they glide along the slip plane, and if there are any barriers to the dislocation motion, any barriers to the dislocation motion, for example, dispersoids, precipitates, all these are an obstacles to the dislocation motion. If there is a precipitate or a dispersoid, which is an obstacle, so this is the dislocation source. This is the dislocation source and this is an obstacle. So, when the dislocation, edge dislocations, they glide along the slip plane and they encounter an obstacle, that may be either precipitate or dispersoid, the dislocation cannot move. It requires for the dislocation to bypass this obstacle, it requires very high stress. If the stress is low, then the dislocation cannot bypass this obstacle. So, at higher temperatures, these dislocations, they can move by a process known as climb. That means, they can move out of this slip plane. That means, they can climb this obstacle. They can move out of the slip plane and move to another parallel slip plane, and they can glide in this slip plane until again they encounter one more obstacle. So, at low stresses and higher temperatures, the dislocation, they move by this process known as climb and glide. Because for the dislocation to bypass this obstacle, it requires very high stress. When the stresses are not that high, the dislocation cannot bypass this obstacle. And if the temperatures are high, so the dislocation can overcome this obstacle by the thermally activated process, and by means of vacancies, it can climb onto the next parallel slip plane, and then it can glide until it encounters one more obstacle. Again, by the process of climb, which is a diffusion control process, because it involves vacancies also for the dislocation in order to climb. Again, it climbs and again it moves on to the another slip plane. It leaves the slip plane and moves into the other slip plane. Again, it can glide. So, like this, the motion of dislocation can take place at higher temperatures and at somewhat lower stresses. So, these acts as obstacles. The precipitates are dispersoids. So, if dislocation creep is the dominant mechanism, then by means of these precipitates or by means of these dispersoids, one can lower the creep rate. Why? Because sufficient temperature is also required for the dislocation to climb. If the temperatures are low, then the dislocation cannot bypass this obstacle. That means it cannot climb onto the another slip plane, parallel slip plane, and then only it can glide along this slip plane. So, dislocation creep, it is controlled by the motion of dislocation, where it climbs, it leaves the slip plane at the obstacle, it climbs onto the next parallel slip plane, and then again it glides. Therefore, the rate controlling step is climb. Climb is a rate controlling step, and glide, where the dislocations, they glide on the slip plane until they encounter one more obstacle. So, the rate controlling step is determined by the climb, and the strain is determined by the glide. The strain that takes place, it is determined by the glide, where the dislocation glides, and the rate controlling step is climb. So, this is the process of dislocation creep. So, dislocation creep, if this is the dominant deformation mechanism, if one finds out for a particular combination of stress and temperature, dislocation creep is a dominant deformation mechanism, then one can slow down this process by placing number of obstacles, that is the precipitates and dispersoids. Because if there is a sufficient temperature, then only the dislocation can undergo the climb, and then it undergoes glide. So, this is climb and this is glide. So, dislocation creep, it is controlled by the motion of dislocations by the process known as climb and glide. So, this is also known as climb, glide, creep. Climb, glide, creep. So, this deformation mechanism, it depends upon stress more when compared to that of diffusion creep. The dependency of stress is more for this type of deformation mechanism, that is dislocation creep. It depends upon stress more than that of the diffusion creep. So, this is a plot which shows a creep rate which is normalized by the diffusion coefficient and stress normalized by the shear modulus. So, the minimum creep rate, it is given by A sigma to the power of n dV by kT. So, power law creep, which we have discussed earlier in the previous module. So, this is the first region where it is essentially a linear, where n takes the values of 1. Creep rate is given by the equation A sigma to the power of n dV by kT. kT, that is the diffusion, volume diffusion coefficient by kT. So here, this at low stresses, this region is known as Harper-Dorn creep, that is the stage 1, it is known as Harper-Dorn creep. Harper-Dorn creep, this is for very low values of stress, where essentially creep rate versus stress is linear. In the second region, where the power law equation holds, the power law equation holds, where n can take values up to 5. And the third stage, where the stresses are very, very high, creep rates are also very high, and the power law breakdown occurs. That means the power law is not valid in this region because the stresses are very high, the creep rates are also very high. Therefore, the power law is not valid. So, this region is known as power law breakdown region at very high stresses. This is the second region where the power law holds and n can take values up to 5, and this n can in the first region where it is essentially a linear. The creep rate, which is normalized by the diffusion coefficient, and stress normalized by the shear modulus. So, second stage where the power law holds, and third stage where the stresses are very high. As I said earlier in the previous module, that the power law does not hold, that means this equation does not hold at very high values of stress because the creep rates are also very high. Therefore, the power law breaks down. So, this is known as the power law breakdown region. Then the second diffusion, second type of mechanism, creep deformation mechanism, it is diffusion creep. So, diffusion creep, it takes place at higher temperatures and lower stresses when compared to that of dislocation creep, where the stresses are low for the dislocation motion to be activated. So, the creep rates, they are governed by the deformation mechanism, it is governed by means of diffusion controlled mechanisms. So, when compared to dislocation creep, the stresses are low and the temperatures are high. The stresses are very low such that the dislocation motion cannot be activated at such low stress. So, the deformation mechanism is mainly due to the diffusion controlled mechanisms. Okay. So, in the diffusion creep, we have two types. One is Navarro-Herring creep, which is also known as NH creep, and second one is known as Kobel creep. So, if we consider a grain, so in the case of diffusion creep, the mass flow takes place from the sides of the grain, atoms flow from the sides of the grain to top and to the bottom. At the mass flow takes place from the side of the grain to the top and to the bottom. So, the movement of vacancies is in the opposite direction. Okay? So, the movement of atoms from the sides of the grain takes place to the top and to the bottom. So, this solid line represents the volume diffusion, and the dotted line, it represents grain boundary diffusion. So, this solid line represents lattice diffusion, and dotted line, it represents grain boundary diffusion. So, diffusion creep, it is simply governed by the diffusion control mechanisms, where the mass flow takes place from the side of the grains, that means the atoms flow from side of the grains to the top and to the bottom, which are indicated by the arrows. Solid line arrows indicates lattice diffusion, and these dotted arrows indicates grain boundary diffusion. In the case of Navarro-Herring creep. So, there is a flow of vacancies flow of vacancies where the grain boundaries, where the grain is experiencing, where the grain is experiencing a tensile stress to that of the area where it is experiencing a compressive stress. In the case of Navarro Herring creep and H creep, there is a flow of vacancies from this indicates atoms, and for the case of NH creep, there is a flow of vacancies from the region where it is experiencing a tensile stress to the region. So, this arrow now indicates the flow of vacancies. This arrow indicates the flow of vacancies from the region experiencing tensile stress to the region which experiences a compressive stress. So, correspondingly there is a motion of atoms in the opposite direction. So, thereby the grain shape changes during this diffusion creep. The grain shape changes during this diffusion creep. The difference between NH creep and Coble creep is the diffusion. Lattice diffusion takes place in the case of NH creep, and whereas in the case of Coble creep, grain boundary diffusion, that means diffusion takes place only along the grain boundaries, that is for the case of Coble creep, because it operates at temperatures slightly lower when compared than to that of NH creep. The temperature at which Coble creep operates, it is lower when compared to that of Navarro Herring creep, and diffusion is very sensitive to temperature. So, at low temperatures, the activation energy for the grain boundaries diffusion, it is less. Thereby, at this low temperatures, which is governed by this grain boundary diffusion, this takes place at low temperatures, that is the Coble creep, which occurs at low temperatures, and at higher temperatures lattice diffusion takes place. So, this is the only difference between the Navarro Herring creep and Coble creep. Navarro Herring creep, lattice diffusion takes place, that is the volume diffusion takes place, and in the case of Coble creep, diffusion along the grain boundaries only takes place. So, because this operates at lower temperatures, and when the temperatures are low, the activation energy for grain boundary diffusion is less than the activation energy for lattice diffusion. So, lattice diffusion takes place at Navarro Herring creep and grain boundary diffusion takes place at Coble creep. The activation energy for grain boundary diffusion is less, it is less than the activation energy for lattice diffusion. So, this takes place at low temperature when compared to that of this lattice diffusion, that is Navarro Herring creep, at high temperatures. Therefore, this is Coble creep and this is Navarro Herring creep. So, diffusion creep means where the dislocation motion, it is not activated at low stresses, then the deformation mechanism, which is predominantly controlled by the diffusion control mechanisms. So, that is known as diffusion creep. We have two types, Navarro Herring and Coble creep. So, in this, the atoms from the sides of the grains, they flow to the top and to the bottom. So, the areas which experience a tensile stress, the vacancies move from that region to that of region which experiences compressive stress. Opposite direction is the atom movement. Thereby, the grain shape changes, grain elongation takes place, deformation takes place. And Coble creep and Navarro Herring creep, it is given by the equation. For the case of NH creep, Navarro Herring creep, the creep rate is given by the equation and cobalt creep, it is given by the equation 50 sigma b power 4. The lattice, this is the lattice diffusion, that is the volume diffusion and grain boundary diffusion by kT into d cube, and this is d square. So, this is the creep rate equation, it is approximately equal to for the case of Nabarro-Herring creep, and this is for the case of Kobol creep. So, it can be seen that Kobol creep, where grain boundary diffusion takes place. So, it is at lower temperature when compared to Nabarro-Herring creep. Nabarro-Herring creep, the volume diffusion, there is a lattice diffusion takes place. And one more important parameter we can observe here is D. T is a temperature, sigma is the stress, B is the Burgers vector, dV is the volume diffusion, lattice diffusion coefficient, K is the Boltzmann constant, and D is the grain diameter. Similarly, in the case of Kobol creep, we have d cube. So, Kobol creep is more sensitive to grain diameter when compared to that of Nabarro-Herring creep. So, from this it can be observed that creep rate is inversely proportional to grain diameter. So, coarser grain, the creep rate is lower, because coarser the grain, the diffusion path is more. That means, larger the grain size, the diffusion path is more. So, lower will be the creep rate. So, normally we prefer for low to intermediate temperature, we prefer a fine grain size which has a good strength and ductility. Whereas, at higher temperatures, coarser grain, because the diffusion path is more, the creep rates are lower. So, for very high temperature applications, one prefer a coarser grain when compared to that of fine grain. So, this is about the diffusion creep. Even though the process is very, very slow, but this process is significant when the stresses are low, such that the dislocation motion is not activated, then the deformation is controlled by solely by diffusion. Next, the third mechanism is grain boundary sliding. The third deformation mechanism is grain boundary sliding. So, as the grain changes the shape, in order to maintain the continuity of grains. So, these grain centers have to move in order to maintain the grain continuity along the grain boundaries. So, these grains, they rotate and they slide. So, this occurs, this grain boundary sliding, it occurs mainly in the final stages of creep, that is the tertiary creep. In the final stages of creep, is the third stage creep, that is before final failure, this grain boundary sliding takes place. In the tertiary creep, this grain boundary sliding takes place. So, in the diffusion creep, as the grain elongation takes place because of the mass flow, in order to maintain the continuity of the grain and grain boundaries, the grain centers have to move along in order to maintain the continuity of the grain. Thereby, grains, they rotate and they slide and finally leads to rupture. Grain boundaries, they undergo sliding and finally leads to rupture. So, the precipitate particles, carbide particles, they play a very major role, because they pin down the grain boundaries, they prevent this grain boundary sliding. So, this occurs at the final stages of creep.